Hey y'all, this is Dr. Carmen Corder with thedoctornurse.com, and in this real short video, I want to just describe some important differences between two of the most common endocrine disorders you're going to learn about in nursing school, SIADH and diabetes insipidus. So both of these disorders are disorders of the posterior pituitary. Your posterior pituitary is what produces ADH or antidiuretic hormone. All right, so I want to go over the etiologies, the patho, and the most notable signs and symptoms of each of these disorders. All right, so we'll start with SIADH, which stands for Syndrome of Inappropriate Antidiuretic Hormone. So basically, SIADH is when there is too much antidiuretic hormone being produced. The way I remembered this in nursing school was by soggy SIADH, all right? There's too much water. So the etiologies that you see that I have listed here, number one is gonna be an oat cell carcinoma, that's a lung cancer. Number two, a viral pneumonia. And number three, head problems. And by head problems, I mean head trauma. Neurosurgery, some sort of tumor, all right? So head problems. But the number one etiology is going to be oat cell carcinoma. So for whatever reason, this oat cell carcinoma causes the posterior pituitary to start overproducing antidiuretic hormone. And what antidiuretic hormone does is it goes directly to the kidneys and tells the kidneys to hang on to fluid, all right? So what we have is signs and symptoms of a fluid volume excess. All right, so we've got way too much fluid on board. We have a soggy SIADH, S-I-A-D-H. So with too much fluid on board, we're going to see a state of what's called hemodilution. And with hemodilution, your serum sodium is going to appear very low, all right, because it is diluted out. Also, because of the amount of volume that's on board, you're going to see edema. Your patient will be hypertensive. Your patient will have bounding pulses, all right? And that doesn't have anything to do with the heart rate, but the quality. They're going to be bounding when you put your finger on the pulse to feel the pulse. And then the most scariest potential complication that you need to monitor for with SIADH obviously is going to be pulmonary edema, all right, because of fluid volume overload. You also are going to need to place your patient on seizure precautions. As that sodium goes down, 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 we know that sodium plays a big role in nerve transmission in the nervous system, and when sodium is very low and when it's diluted out, like such as in SIADH, then your patient is at risk for seizures. All right, so watch for pulmonary edema, so listen to those lung sounds, and seizure precautions if your sodium drops way below normal. All right, so the great thing about endocrine is, like, if you learn one disorder, then you know its opposite, okay? Because it's diabetes insipidus is the direct opposite of SIADH. Don't really know why it's called diabetes insipidus, because it doesn't behave like diabetes mellitus, right? But diabetes insipidus, you'll see that the number one etiology that I have listed for it is head problems, all right? So any patient that comes in that's a neuro patient, they've had a brain injury, they've had head trauma, they've had neurosurgery, a brain tumor, cerebral edema, any kind of head problem, you've got to watch them for diabetes insipidus. And so with diabetes insipidus, that posterior pituitary has been damaged for whatever reason, and it's not able to produce antidiuretic hormone. Now that's what we call neurogenic diabetes insipidus, meaning that the issue stems from the pituitary itself. There's also a form of diabetes insipidus called nephrogenic, and that just means that there's something wrong with the kidneys, that they're not able to respond to the antidiuretic hormone. All right, but for testing purposes, most often you're going to be tested over the neurogenic form where the posterior pituitary itself is not able to produce that ADH. So what happens if you don't have enough antidiuretic hormone telling the kidneys to hang on to water, the kidneys are going to let go of water, and they're going to let go of a lot of water. All right, so up to 20 liters per day of fluid loss with diabetes insipidus. So you're definitely going to see a fluid volume deficit, and you're going to see a state of hemoconcentration with your patient. So that sodium level is going to be falsely elevated. So with your fluid volume deficit, you're going to see the very opposite signs and symptoms. You will see a hypotension. You will see compensatory tachycardia. Your patient's pulses will be weak and thready. They may have dry mucous membranes. They may have pale skin. They may have weight loss, all right? So our biggest concern with diabetes insipidus is going to be hypovolemic shock, all right? So when your patient starts showing those signs of shock, which is basically a low blood pressure that doesn't respond well to fluids and things like that, then that's when diabetes insipidus has now gone into its potential complication of hypovolemic shock. All right, so believe it or not, the nursing care is kind of going to be the same for both disorders. We're worried with a fluid volume excess with SIADH. We're worried about a fluid volume deficit with diabetes insipidus. So with both of those disorders, we're going to be monitoring the same vital signs, right? Heart rate and blood pressure. We're going to be monitoring eyes and O's, obviously, because one, we're hanging on to too much fluid. The other one, we're losing too much fluid. So we're going to be watching eyes and O's. We're going to be performing daily weights, all right? But we're monitoring those components with different expectations, right? So kind of doing the same thing, but with different goals in mind, because with SIADH, we want to prevent the patient from developing pulmonary edema and really high blood pressure and possibly seizures because of fluid overload. But with diabetes insipidus, we want to prevent them from going into hypovolemic shock because of a fluid volume deficit. Now, one thing that you will do for diabetes insipidus is you can administer like a synthetic antidiuretic hormone. It's called desmopressin. With SIADH, you'll be giving diuretics and restricting fluid, right? All right. So that is just a real quick overview of SIADH versus diabetes insipidus. There is a real handy little infographic of this information posted under the mini pathophysiology course on the website. So I urge you, if you're watching this from YouTube, go ahead, head over to the website, check out the reference guide for these two endocrine disorders. I hope you've learned something from this, and I hope you all have a wonderful rest of the semester, a great night, and thank you so much for watching my video.